So you got your Speedway straight axle slammed into your super cool new Gasser project, but now, how do you get it to turn? I'm gonna save you some time. I spent dozens of hours going through old internet forum posts, and I'm gonna make a compendium of those tips and tricks here for you today. This is gonna be quick, it's not gonna be complicated. I'm just gonna give you the bare bones of what you need to get your straight axle Gasser going down the road. Hopefully straight. Stick around. What's up, everybody? I'm Jeremy. Welcome back to Campus Motorsports, and this is my 1966 Fairlane. This is a drag and drive project for the Gasser class, straight axle. This is a kit from Speedway. It's going to be very similar, if not the exact same thing, to what a lot of you guys are using. So I want to show you the steering setup that I'm putting together for this, because it just doesn't seem like there's a lot out there that's easy access. You know, I watched a couple of videos where guys are drawing crazy diagrams on a whiteboard. Please find those and watch those if you want something that advanced. This is gonna be super simple. I'm just gonna give you some safety tips for Heim joint steering, and we'll talk a little bit about steering box selection and stuff like that. Okay, let's jump right into the car here, literally. Now, one of these days, I'm planning on doing a whole video of getting this thing, you know, running. I have most of the parts to do it, but some of the parts that I don't have are of the really expensive variety. So we're just kind of on hold for funding there. But as you can see, I already have my general steering box setup put in here. I'm not gonna go too much over how I did that. There's not a lot to it. I bought a mount for this box and used an existing hole in the frame, put a bolt through, welded the rest of it together. There's no point in going super in depth because this part, you're gonna have to do yourself. Hopefully, you can use your steering box in the factory location. That would be great. My case, I gave it a shot, didn't work. Start welding. Rules for your steering shaft. You're allowed to have two universal joints just like this before you would have to add a support bearing of some kind. So if you needed to make some sort of crazy zigzag to get around your exhaust, you can add another joint or you can add a double joint, but at that point you would need to add a support bearing. Again, that doesn't need to be complicated. Almost all these aftermarket steering systems are designed on a 3/4 inch double D shaft. So that means all you would need for a support bearing is a 3/4 inside diameter Heim joint. Just figure out a way to weld it onto your chassis somewhere, buy a quality joint, you're done. Doesn't need to be specifically for steering, just needs to be 3/4 diameter so this fits through it. Because our steering box is way up here, forward of the axle, this is a front steer setup. Factory, the steering box is mounted back here, basically running straight into the steering column, that would make it a rear steer. Now, a lot of people seem to think that you need a different steering box for front and rear steer setups. That is not the case. It's the same box. Difference is the pitman arm is mounted towards the front of the car in rear steer, and in a front steer setup like this, it's mounted backwards towards the back of the car. But the steering box is the same unless you get like wacky with a side steer setup or something like that. Those do exist, and they do exist in, especially in the hot rod world. It's not really gonna come into play for most of you guys that are, especially if you're using a Saginaw box like I am. Let's talk a little bit about steering box selection. So this dude right here is a Saginaw 525 manual steering box. They came in all sorts of stuff. I would say they're probably generally most associated with GM vehicles, but man, they came in everything from Monte Carlos all the way up to Jeep Wranglers from 1962-ish all the way up until the late 80s, early 90s. This is a new, probably Chineseium, sort of repro box that's spec'd out for a Jeep Wrangler with manual steer from like 1985, 87. I always forget the TJ, YJ stuff with Jeeps, but that's what this is for. The only difference between this box and like a Chevelle box, which they would have commonly come in, is the newer ones that came in like G-bodies and Jeeps and stuff like that in the 80s have a 3/4 input shaft, and the old ones had a 13/16. Either one will work. It's easier to find the 3/4 stuff as far as U-joints and things like that. So I opted to go that way, and I got a new box. I'll grab that later, don't worry about that. When you're talking hot rods, and especially Gassers, you'll hear the term Vega box thrown around quite a bit. All that is that it's also a Saginaw box. They're smaller. I don't really recommend them now, and a lot, it's not just me. If you go around the forums, a lot of people don't recommend them now. Specifically, for heavier cars like this. I mean, this is a mid-sized car. It's not gonna be crazy heavy, but Vegas are light cars. They do really well in like light hot rod situations, but if you're gonna have a car that's up over 3,000 pounds, you should really go with the more beefy 525. Nice thing is, The bolt pattern is exactly the same. So if you're looking for accessories to help you mount your box easier, don't shy away if it says Vega. It's gonna be the same thing if you're using a Saginaw box. Now, I did try to use mine in the factory location, not have to fabricate anything, but it just didn't work. It was too high. The oil pan was gonna be in the way. It was easier in my case to just go with the front steer setup. And once you do have to get custom, 9 times out of 10, Saginaw is the way to go. Let me give you another reason why. So we mentioned that the Vega box and the 525 have the same bolt pattern. This is a Saginaw 800 series power steering gear. So if I were to decide after driving this for a season or two that I'm just too wimpy to be steering around a manual steering car with my noodle arms and want power steering, this will bolt right in place. Now, when you buy your straight axle kit, it's going to come with the tie rod. That's the piece that's back there behind that is tying the two wheels together. What it is not going to come with, and what you're going to have to order custom, is your drag link. That's going to go from your pitman arm over to the wheel, which is going to make the magic happen when you turn your steering wheel. So obviously you need to get your steering gearbox and your pitman arm in place before you can measure for your drag link here. Now, I've already done that on mine. We're going to see today if I measured correctly or not. But before we do that, let's talk a little bit about positioning your steering box, and even more so by proxy, that pitman arm. Now, because the front end is jacked up, a lot of times if you don't take measures against it, let's say your pitman arm is over here and your spindle connection is over here, you're going to end up something like that. What you want to try to do is get it as flat as you possibly can. Now, when we get in here and look at mine, mine is not perfect, but because I used a special 4-inch drop pitman arm, it's going to be a lot better than what it would have been if I hadn't taken that measure. The other thing is you really want it to be as straight as possible down the length of the axle. I mean, if you look at your tie rod tube, it's perfectly parallel with the axle. You would like your drag link to be as close as possible to parallel as well. Mine's not going to be perfect, but again, it's not terrible. It doesn't have to be complicated. If it makes it easier for you to visualize, when you look at your drag link from straight overhead, or straight in front, you want it to be as parallel to the axle as possible. Mine, as we'll see, is not perfect, but it's close enough that I don't think it's gonna cause me any major problems. Worst case scenario, we end up moving the steering box a little bit more towards the front of the car. This is also where trick pitman arms can come into play. Pitman arms come in all shapes and sizes. I showed you my drop one to get it lower down. You might be able to find a pitman arm with a quirky shape that puts it right where you need it to be without having to move the box. Now, most of you guys in these setups, especially because they come like this from Speedway, are going to be using Heim joints. You'll also hear them called rod ends for your steering joints. There are some steps that you need to take, especially when they're mounted in a single shear like they are in most of these applications, to make sure you're operating safely. Now, first of all, no-brainer stuff, buy quality Heim joints. These are not the cheapest things off the shelf, and I went beefier than I really needed to. These are 3/4 Heim joints that we're gonna neck down with our spacer to be able to use 5/8 bolts. Also super obvious, use nice grade 8 hardware. Don't skimp on the hardware. Okay, so when we say mounted in single shear, I'll find a little diagram to put up, but it's pretty simple. You're only pulling in one dimension. Double shear would be if you had a fork set up like this, and then you had your bolt through it. That's all that means. Double shear is safer. There's Heim joints do not particularly like single shear. That's why you buy quality Heim joints, and that's why you take the next step that we're gonna talk about. This little guy is a safety washer. It's made specifically for Heim joints. I got mine with the rest of the stuff from Barnes 4-Wheel Drive. TMR Customs also makes them, and they have a really cool graphic on their website that I'll show you here because it displays this pretty easily. But the moral of the story is when a Heim joint fails, see, you've got your ball in the middle here, that ball that is captive right now becomes uncaptive. When that ball becomes uncaptive, it's a bad scene. So that's where these safety washers come in. What these do, the small end matches the diameter of your ball. The big end is larger, so what happens is, if you have a failure, this now cannot slide past the big end. So now we picture we have one of these on both sides. Even if this fails, while you might get your steering sloppy all of a sudden, it can actually go past these safety washers, and it'll be able to get you off the road, maybe even get you home. You also have to be wary of how much angle you have in them. Now, if you did what I said and try to get it as flat as possible, you shouldn't have to worry about it. But if you do, there's a solution for that as well, and they're called high misalignment spacers. This one, and I don't know if anybody else makes this, this is also from Barnes 4-Wheel Drive, is above and beyond because it is a high misalignment safety spacer. So here's a standard spacer, here's the safety spacer. Same principle, so if your ball joint fails, it can't slide past this big heavy head on this thing here. So now let's thread this guy into our nice big thick chromoly drag link here, made by the wonderful people at Where's Machine. Made in America, that's nice, and it has left hand, right hand stamped on it for those of us who are dyslexically challenged. Always use anti-seize on these. This is from a company called Steel Camel. They make anti-seize that does not spread everywhere and get all over you. I've been using it for like a year now, and I really like it. It doesn't spread quite as easy, so that's kind of the one drawback, but because it doesn't spread as easy, it doesn't get all over you. So you can touch this without wearing gloves and not feel like you're gonna need to take 7 baths afterwards. All right, here we go, install. We do have a little bit of angle, a little more than I want, honestly. I could have moved this further forward. It would have gotten some interference issues with maybe the bit radiator here though. And like I said, I really wanted to use a hole that was already existing there. We see our tie rod on the bottom, axle tube, drag link. A touch of angle, but not bad at all. Now, one thing I don't have here that I will almost certainly add, and you probably should too, is a steering stabilizer. And that steering stabilizer will mount to your axle tube and then either your drag link or your tie rod. And it's basically gonna be a shock absorber that's going to absorb any bump steer or just general steering vibrations that you have. All right, let's test this sucker, see if she turns the wheels. Right, hey, turning right, left. Turning left. And you know, if you guys find that you can't find parts or wanna watch some more videos, maybe some more in-depth videos of people doing this type of stuff with straight axle steering, stop looking for Gasser stuff and start looking at 4x4 stuff, because the principles are the same and it's a lot easier to find. So if you're struggling to find Gasser specific stuff, just stop trying and start looking at rock crawling type stuff. You'll save yourself a lot of time. That's gonna do it, guys. Thanks for watching. We now have a straight axle Gasser project that turns right when we tell it to and left when we tell it to. Hopefully this helps you get your straight axle project sorted out as well. And I am one step closer to getting this thing on drag week. Now I just gotta finish the firewall, figure out how to make it stop, and buy a really expensive clutch, and find somebody to put in a roll cage. Hot rodding is depressing.